In this lesson, we're going to deal with a topic called arc length. So here's the idea. Let's say we have a curve, y equals f of x, and let's specifically say that it's a friendly curve with a continuous first derivative. So here's an example right here, a curve y equals f of x. Now let's say that I'd like to know the length of the curve between the two points x equals a and x equals b. So x equals a here, x equals b here, and I want to know the length of the curve between those x values. And this is called arc length. So based on your mathematical knowledge so far, you have no way of measuring the length of this curve. But we're going to develop a way, and we're going to think through it step by step together. Think back to when we learned how to compute the area under a curve. We didn't know how to do that either, but what we did is we started with an approximation and we went from there. And that's the same strategy we're going to use here. And specifically, we're going to use what you might call a slice and sum strategy. So I may not know how to find the length of a curve, but I do know how to find the length of a straight line. So let's imagine zooming in on one little segment of our arc. And if this segment is small enough, its length is approximately equal to the length of a line segment through its endpoints, like this. That's the first big idea here. Let's go back to our full curve. What I'm going to do next is divide my interval from A to B into n subintervals, thus creating a grid of x values, just like we did when we learned about Riemann sums. And I'm going to use an even partition here so that the width of each subinterval is given by delta x equals b minus a over n, just like Riemann sums. And then each subinterval can be labeled by the index k for k equals 1 through n. So for example, this is subinterval k equals 1, k equals 2, k equals 3, and so on up to k equals n. So don't let those k's trip you up. That's just an index. So next, for each subinterval, I'm going to approximate the curve segment by a straight line segment. And that'll look like this. Okay, so once again, on each little subinterval, what I've done is I've approximated the curve, which you see in green here, by a straight line segment. So the idea here is that we'll approximate the arc length between x equals a and x equals b by finding the length of all these little straight line segments and then adding them up. And if delta x is small, this should be a pretty good approximation. But first we need to figure out how to find the length of one of the line segments. So let's zoom in. So what I'm doing is I'm zooming in to subinterval k, what's shown in this red circle here, and then I'm looking a little closer at that line segment. Okay, so what I'm trying to do is I'm going to try to find the length of this little line segment. And the way we're going to do this is by using Pythagorean Theorem. So then, we need to know the length of the legs of this little right triangle. Well, this horizontal leg here, down here, is going to be given by the change in x coordinates, which is just delta x. So this is the delta x that's the same for every subinterval since we're using an even partition. And if you recall, that was delta x equals b minus a over n. Now the length of my vertical leg here is just going to be the absolute value of the change in the y coordinates, which we'll call delta y sub k. And this quantity will be different for every subinterval. So then I can use the Pythagorean theorem once again to find the hypotenuse of the triangle. which is the length of this line segment that I'm interested in. And Pythagorean's theorem says that that hypotenuse, the length of that hypotenuse should be the square root of delta x squared plus delta y sub k quantity squared. And I went ahead and dropped the absolute value signs on that delta y sub k here, since squaring something makes it positive anyway. So remember that my ultimate goal is to add up all these little line segments to get an approximation for the length of the entire curve. So to do that, I'm going to simply use summation notation. So the length of the curve is approximately equal to the sum over all the subintervals, and so I can write that as k equals 1 to n, of the expression we just found, which was the square root of delta x quantity squared plus delta y sub k quantity squared. So this gives us an approximation for this arc length between x equals a and x equals b. Now, following the pattern we used in Riemann sums, the next thing we'd like to do is make this approximation exact by taking the limit as the number of subintervals n goes to infinity. However, there's one step that we have to do first. It's going to cause issues to have both x's and y's in this expression. So I'm going to try somehow to rewrite this delta y sub k. So first we're going to need to do a bit of algebra. I'm going to start by factoring out a delta x squared underneath the square root. So pulling out a delta x squared. And when I factor out a delta x squared, that means I need to divide both terms by delta x squared. So I get the following. Delta x squared times a quantity 1 plus delta y sub k squared over delta x squared. And next, I am going to split up this root like so. The square root of delta x quantity squared times the square root of 1 plus, and I'm going to write this as the quantity delta y sub k over delta x quantity squared. Now I can make a little simplification because I have the square root of delta x squared. Now technically, this reduces to the absolute value of delta x, but since delta x is always positive anyway, I don't really need to include those absolute value symbols. So then what I get is I get the sum of delta x times the square root of 1 plus the quantity delta y sub k over delta x squared. Now we need to use a cool little trick. To do this trick, we have to recall the mean value theorem. So consider a curve like this one and a secant line through the points A, f of A, and B, f of B. So a little secant line like this one. The mean value theorem states that at some point on this interval AB, there is a tangent line with the same slope as a secant line, like this one. So why does this matter? So here, delta y sub k over delta x is the slope of a secant line. And specifically, it's the slope of the little line segment that we drew before in our previous illustration. The line segment that we were using to approximate our curve. So the secant line with the slope delta y sub k over delta x. So then, according to the mean value theorem, there must be some point on our subinterval here where the slope of this secant line equals the slope of a tangent line. And we'll call the special point where this happens x, k star. And every subinterval is going to have one of these special points, x, k star. So what this allows me to do is actually rewrite this expression as delta x times the square root of 1 plus, and I can rewrite this delta y sub k over delta x as f prime of x k star squared. Because recall that the derivative is the slope of the tangent line. So now we have everything in terms of x, which is nice. So now, finally, we can go ahead and take the limit as n goes to infinity to get the exact arc length. So if I do that, I'm going to get that the arc length equals the limit as n goes to infinity of my sum from k equals 1 to n, and I'm going to write this as the square root of 1 plus f prime of x k star squared delta x. And just like we did in Riemann sums, we can express this summation as a definite integral. And if we do that, it's going to be the definite integral from a to b of the square root of 1 plus f prime of x squared dx. And this here is what we'll use to compute arc length. And note that for this formula to work, we do have to have a continuous derivative f prime of x.